So we're going to look at some installation tips in part 12. You know how to design the network, and we've gone over installation quite a bit in the other videos. So I'm not gonna explain how to run data cable. I'm not gonna explain how to rack mount switch or wall mount an equipment or wall mount an AP, I should say, or configure a controller or configure a switch. Those are we can be here forever talking about all the different ways to configure something that's beyond the scope of these videos. So if it's a new building under construction and you're responsible for installing the structured cable in the building, you're probably going to install the data cable after the framing is complete and before the ceiling tiles and drywall are installed. You can leave the bundles of data cable up in the ceiling. Be careful that the bundles aren't pulling on the rest of the cable because they can be heavy and that can damage the cable. Once you've got power, internet, flooring, and the IDF or MDF, you can install network racks, rack mount, and configure your switches, that kind of thing. You can also terminate the data cables to the patch panel, and you can certify your data cables, which is a very, very good idea. Highly recommend you buy or rent a cable certifier. And of course, once you've installed your dropped ceiling, then you can start pulling the wire, terminating the wire in the ceiling, mounting the access points. Most access points have brackets for a drywall and T-bar. I should say that after you've terminated the cable, maybe in this phase, you can do the certification. APs that are going outside can be installed once you've got a completed roof or building envelope, once you've got the final structure that you're bolting your poles and masts to. Highly recommend you configure your access points before you install them. You don't want to be coming back later and installing your access points in the you don't want to come back later and have to rent a scissor lift and climb up in the scissor lift with your laptop to reconfigure access point. For the most part, the access points are configured with a controller unless you have a small network, but maybe it's better to plug access points into the switch directly and make sure all your access points are online on the ground before you start hooking them up in the ceilings and outdoors. A very good idea. Depending on how big the building is and the time frame, you might do the termination of the cable AP install certification all at the same time. That'll save you on labor, scissor lift rentals, ladders, that kind of thing. Every project is different, so be sure to communicate with the GC, subcontractors, and the client at all times. Now, if it's existing construction, then you have to be a little bit more careful here because you're installing access points inside a business that's already operational. You have to comply with their security, safety, occupational health, whatever policies they have. If it's an industrial facility, then you probably have to complete a safety orientation. That means you, your employees, your subcontractors, that could take a day, take half a day, take a few hours. There's all kinds of things they can talk about. And of course, You need to identify the time frame for completing the installation. The client may decide that you won't have to do it in a day or a couple of days or a week, and that's because they don't want a mess and disruption in their office for a month or 2 months. So don't think you can go there, work a few days, and then come back next week and work a couple more days. They may not be happy with that. So consider that you might have to hire contractors or laborers to help you, and make sure they're professional, know what they're doing, and you need to factor that into cost ahead of time. And be careful. In an office, for example, yes, you can run data cable and AP installation for the most part during business hours if the client agrees. Be practical though. You can't install cable in a conference room when the CEO is having a presentation. That's just not going to be acceptable. Be safe, obviously. Don't make a mess, and don't leave tools everywhere and people walking and texting and not paying attention. They could knock you off your ladder. So have somebody watching out for you. And depending on the client, again, if it's not an office, if it's, let's say, a retail store like Lululemon or Walmart, then they're going to say, hey, you definitely can't come in here in the middle of the day and start running cable because it's packed with customers. And it will be very disruptive and not safe either. It's one thing if an employee is irritated. It's another if a customer gets irritated. So you have to be careful. With a warehouse, the same thing. A very busy warehouse might expect you to do the install at night. Airports and shopping malls, that totally depends on the airport and the shopping mall. Some of them are okay with the install during the day simply because they have much wider areas, and they have areas with high traffic and areas with low traffic. So you might tackle the high traffic areas at night and the low traffic areas during the day. Be careful again at night. You need to plan everything out. You might be there only for one night. The client may, because the client has to leave the building open for you at night. So if it's an airport, not a big deal. But if it's a very small retail store, then they have to pay the manager overtime to stay all night with you until the project gets finished. So they don't want to pay overtime for a whole week while you do your thing. So again, make sure you have enough people, and make sure that you have a working scissor lift and the tools and the network equipment before you start. Because if you get to 2 a.m. and you realize you ran out of data cable and you can't just go buy some more at 2 in the morning, I mean, you can, but it's going to be very disruptive and unprofessional, and it's going to waste a lot of time, and time is money. So yeah, like I said, run your cable, terminate it, certify it, install and configure your switches, then configure and mount your access points. Do these steps in order or don't. That's up to you. Sometimes you have to use your judgment depending on the size of the project and the delays and whatever. And another important thing is if you're plugging into an existing network switch, so let's say you're just responsible for running the cable and mounting the access point, then maybe the client is responsible for configuring the switches and controller to work with the new access points. You're just wiring and plugging things in. So find out ahead of time which network switch and port they want you to use, and which port on the switch corresponds to which access point. Sometimes it matters, sometimes it doesn't. If you're responsible for configuring the switches, then get the passwords from the client ahead of time. You know, people go on holidays, so showing up at night to run the wire and hook up the access points and then asking for the password, well, the local office manager who's there looking out for you probably doesn't have any idea what you're doing, so they may not have ability to give you the information. Make sure to save a backup of the config before you make any changes, obviously. And then again, once you've finished your installation, you should go back and make another heat map. You can use Survey Pro or Ekahau or whatever. You can't really test for density like you can for the coverage area. You have to wait until people come in and start using the network. And then, of course, after that, this is an optional step depending on your scope of work. You may be deploying laptops, barcode readers, phones, whatever devices the client is going to be using. So if this is an existing building, then if you deploy the devices right away, users might have time to adjust to a new system. So a client may say, hey, we're installing this inventory management system and it's good to go, but we're not transitioning over right away. We're going to give it a few months, or some people are going to start using it and more people will use it until everybody's on it or whatever. So you can factor in the time that it takes to provide training, and you obviously have to make adjustments to the system based on user feedback. So that's something to consider. If it's a new building, however, it's even worse. So you have a new building and you have brand new devices, so, and then people move into the building and they don't know where anything is. They don't know where the kitchen is, they don't know where the bathrooms are, and now their business is using a completely different computer system for their vital business processes. That's a recipe for disaster. So if you can't implement a system in the old building before they move in, then at least provide everybody with a lot of training before they move into the new building and start using it. So when they move in, if they're unfamiliar with the building, they'll still be familiar with the technology, and that's one less thing that they have to worry about. Because their success, obviously, is your success. So it's very important. Any other tests you can do? Density, you want to make sure, obviously, in the high density area, you want to make sure you can support all the users or devices. Make sure there's no congestion. You gotta make sure, again, that voice over IP phones can roam correctly, that they're not dropping calls. With the applications, you want to test your applications out with users or focus groups. Probably you want to do some penetration testing. If you're the developer or the installer, you want to get a third party to do the penetration testing. not just for a conflict of interest, but also bias that you don't know about. You know, hackers have all kinds of crazy ways to get in. So you want to make sure they can not get in, and if they can, you want to discover the vulnerabilities ahead of time and lock them up